So it means that my work and my hobby are kind of similar things. So when I look around the world, I see energy in everything I'm looking at, and I go down all these rabbit holes of where does that energy come from? You know, how do we produce it? How do we use it? And I find this really fun. It's a little nerdy obsession. So when I look around this room or when I look at you, I think about the energy that we're using right now and then all the energy it took to produce the things I'm looking at. So if we look at your sweater and we think about the dyes that are in it, we think about what factory actually produced that, what fuels went into creating those dyes. There's energy in every step of that. And then when I think about the lights that are all around us and the electricity that right now is being produced at some power plant somewhere nearby, it might be coal, it might be natural gas, it might be nuclear. It's probably a mix of all those things.
So your life is just a series of energy rabbit holes.
Yeah, which is fun. Like, it's fun because when I look at those rabbit holes, what I see is a bunch of technologies and a bunch of options that are solutions to making us healthier, to making our environment healthier, and to making our bodies healthier. So that's actually really fun and positive. Because down each of those rabbit holes, I'm like, there's a solution. How do I use it? There's a solution. How do I pick it up and use that tool in that toolbox? So every technology that we use to produce energy, to produce electricity, also to make the things we use in our daily lives, every single one has trade-offs. Every single one has impacts. And I think about what impacts are we willing to accept, and are we going to make a choice to actually reduce those impacts to transition to things that are cleaner? The good news is we have technologies to make it cleaner today that are available. But this was actually a big thing that I didn't realize when I started my work, which is that we have technologies, and it's not the technologies that are actually the problem of reducing pollution, of making us healthier. It's the choice to use those technologies. It's the choice to retire something we've been using for a while that's been really good to us, that's provided us with a lot of stuff we want, and replace it with something that's healthier for us in the long term. So we are not waiting on breakthroughs, though breakthroughs, of course, help us if we experience them. We have the technologies we need to bring down emissions today, to get us on the path to net zero, to get us on this path to mitigating climate change in line with the Paris Climate Agreement, in line with all these big vision future scenarios we talk about. We haven't made the choice to use them at the speed and scale that we need to actually accomplish our goals. So that's a choice. Now, as we go all the way to net zero, some innovation and some breakthroughs would help us, but they're not strictly necessary. So there's a really big point here, which is that our goal is to get to net zero. And what that means is that we might still emit an amount of greenhouse gases, but we're gonna balance it out. We're gonna, for every ton we put in the air, we're gonna pull a ton out of the air, these types of things. It's a really big, big shift to get there. It means doing a ton of stuff in our buildings and our homes, our cars, our planes, every single thing in this economy, we have to transition to different technologies. We essentially have to just stop burning a lot of stuff and use other technologies instead. I mean, we have built our entire economy, our entire country around using energy, and that energy is mostly supplied by fossil fuels, and that's helped us to develop and grow. It's helped us to improve our quality of life in just too many ways to count, but it has also come with the trade-off of pollution that makes us sick, that's harming our climate, and so now we're transitioning to technologies that don't have as many of those trade-offs. They have different trade-offs, but not that one. So it's not totally the end of the line for fire. Like, we will still burn some things. So here's a point that is really, how am I gonna say this? So an important point in all this is that when we look at the history of energy and we think about all the ways that we use energy, so we burn wood, we burn coal, we burn natural gas, we use nuclear power, we do a lot of different things. What we've done to date is actually just keep adding new energy sources. It's been a whole history of energy additions and not transitions. We haven't really replaced anything. We just found new stuff to put on the stack. So in the future, we'll use more solar panels, more wind turbines, more batteries, more nuclear power plants, more carbon capture and storage than we use today. And we'll use less fossil fuels. So we'll still burn some stuff, but we'll do it in a way that allows us to still minimize climate change, mitigate the impacts, and get us to net zero. We can get there if we make the choice. It's an active choice. It's not going to passively happen. You know, it's something that we will have to commit policies to. We will have to make efforts across the whole country, but in states and cities and companies. If we don't make that active choice, there's no way we'll get there. It's too tough. It's not something that we're on a pathway to just kind of fall into. So when you think about intermediate goals, you think about, okay, 100%, I'm going all the way to net zero. Well, what's something I can do before then? So how do I get halfway there? How do I get a quarter of the way there? So what you do first is you set a baseline. So in the case of the United States, we've set a 2005 baseline. So how many emissions were we putting into the air in 2005? We know we want to get to net zero, so now we can divide it up. So when we start with this 2005 baseline, we know we want to get to net zero. Along the way, you know, what are our intermediate goals? So the Biden administration has said that by 2030, we want to get about halfway there. Well, here's a piece of good news. We're already a quarter of the way there. So because of cheap wind, cheap solar, actually cheap natural gas replacing coal, cheap batteries, we've already reduced emissions from 2005 about 18%, and we're on track to go to about a quarter. I mean, I think there's a bunch of stuff that happened. So one key piece of this is the natural gas replacing coal. Natural gas became cheap, which made it more affordable in a market. It became cheap because we figured out how to do something called hydraulic fracturing. There's trade-offs with fracking. We could do a whole discussion on that one. But the bottom line is we were able to take coal out of the system and put natural gas in. We also saw a lot of investments into solar panels and wind turbines and batteries. And these started in laboratories and government labs and university labs. And we doubled down our investments and were able to get costs down really low to be able to put those into our homes, into our buildings, into our utilities. Overall, I'm trying to think of how to best say this. But I wouldn't say that these changes have happened in absence of big policies and big decisions, because mm-hmm. what we have also seen is a lot of states, a lot of communities making choices to set up renewable portfolio standards, which is just a fancy way of saying we will install this much renewables, zero carbon power, into our electricity system over a period of time. We will require that. It's not optional. We've opted in. We've seen companies say, we want our company to be powered by 100% renewables or 100% zero carbon power. Utilities supply that to us. So we've seen decisions being made, but not across the whole country and not to the degree that we'll need to get to net zero. So recently in the United States, we passed something called the Inflation Reduction Act. Despite what its title is, it's actually a massive piece of energy and climate legislation. And that legislation has a bunch of tax credits, a bunch of tools in it that could help us to get our emissions down faster by, for example, putting more electric vehicles on the road, helping our buildings to become more energy efficient, installing solar panels, these types of things. That bill that we've already passed, it's already been signed by the president, it's already, you know, part of now the fabric of our economy, could get us down another maybe 15%. So you got 25 plus 15, you're at 40. But when we think about what that actually means, what it means is transitioning a lot of our power plants. So how we make electricity, how we do the electrons that are behind these lights all around us right now. So it means replacing fossil fuel power plants with non-fossil fuel ones. It means taking the emissions out of our electricity while we decarbonize cars, while we decarbonize buildings, while we decarbonize parts of our industry. The low-hanging fruit is electricity. That's where we already have momentum. We've already brought down emissions quite a bit. And it's where we have technologies that we can put out there sooner rather than later. The other reason it's the low-hanging fruit is because when I talk about electricity and power plants, I'm talking about thousands of things. When I talk about cars, for example, I'm talking about hundreds of millions of cars. So if I want to be able to replace something quick, one versus a million is a lot easier. So when I think about a zero carbon grid and how we get to zero carbon electricity, I think of it as a team sport. You need a lot of different types of technologies all playing together if you want to win the game. So you're going to have variable renewables. You're going to have wind and solar. So when they're around, they're cheap. That's great. But they fade sometimes. The wind goes away, the sun sets. So you complement them with other team members, like energy storage. So energy storage is batteries, but it's a lot more than batteries. The point of energy storage is saying, you know what? I can produce electricity right now, but I don't need it. Well, let me hold on to it. Let me put it in a savings account and cash it out later. And then you complement those two types of technologies with firm dispatchable power, which is a nerdy way of saying something that's around 24/7, 365. This is things like nuclear power, and it's things like big hydropower plants. So big power plants that use a lot of water. So if we have all these technologies on the field together, we get affordable, reliable, zero carbon power. If we take any one of these different teammates off the field, we won't win the game. We end up with unaffordable or unreliable power.